Thank you, Mr. President. I rise today to introduce this bill which amends the provisions around the small venues licence within the Liquor Licensing Act. Members would be well aware that when we debated
the small venues provisions now in the Liquor Licensing Act, or small bars as they're more colloquially known,
there was a lot of
wistful hope that these small bars would not just be in the CBD, and indeed just within the confines of north, south, east and west terraces of our capital city, but indeed I remember the member from Schubert hoping that there would be one of these small bars, or perhaps a few of these small bars in the Barossa sometime soon. The member from Morfitt thought that Glenelg would be a wonderful place for some of these small bars. And so it went on in the debate, both here in the other, and in the other place, because when this small venues provision, currently in the Liquor Licensing Act, was introduced with the criteria that these particular venues would, by virtue of their smallness of size, being a capacity of 120 or less patrons, be free from the red tape, most particularly around entertainment consent, but certainly given a streamlined process for young entrepreneurs, old entrepreneurs, any entrepreneurs, to embrace and enter the small bar market and to create diverse and lively spots for South Australians to enjoy. Now, for the first year of that legislation, they were to be in the CBD only, and as I say, between north and south and east and west terraces. Beyond that particular year, there was a provision in the bill that then became part of the Act that the Minister could allow for the prescribed areas for these small venues, licences or small bars, to proliferate and to bloom a thousand flowers across our state. As we know, since 2013, we recently had the announcement from Minister Rao that these small bars, currently confined between North and South Terrace and East and West Terrace, are moving beyond North Terrace at long last. They're going all the way to North Adelaide and no further. And yet we know that the LGA, the Local Government Association, has been lobbying the Minister for small bars across our state. So what my bill does today is takes the control of that decision about where these small venue licences can be, where small bars in South Australia can be, out of the hands of Minister Rao, and gives councils that power to put their hands up to have small bars in their localities. As we know, there's seven state strategic federal government priorities. We boast about them, we hear ad nauseum. Two of these are premium food and wine from our clean environment and creating a vibrant city. Both of these, of course, are embodied in our fantastic small bar culture. Indeed, the exciting and innovative small bar scene has seen the rise of local gin distilleries, late night gourmet cheese platters and festival, a place to quietly chat without a noisy happy hour and a heinous cover of a band playing Jessie's Girl. Not that there's anything wrong with that. All that great food and wine or gin in this vibrant small bar culture sadly still begins and ends in our CBD only. Does it really benefit our state to keep all that great boutique bar vibrancy from spilling beyond the parklands? I for one don't think it does. Why should punters on Peel Street have better access to a deconstructed sham water cocktail that hipsters in Upper Harrow Hill might? In fact, there's been 73 of this new category of small venue licence in operation since they started in 2013, and they are all currently in the CBD. While that's culturally welcomed, it's also a great economic boost. The report commissioned by Renewal SA in 2015 has found that the then 51 CBD-based small bars were already employing over 400 people and had generated more than $49.3 million in economic activity. Indeed, if you take a walk down any of Adelaide's new laneways, you can see for yourself the positive effects the changes have had. And yet it stops short at the parklands, and the state government is slow to share these benefits beyond those parklands. A small venue licence allows for entrepreneurs to set up a diverse range of lovely, often hipster venues by cutting red tape, as long as they keep the small, under 120 people small. venue licence allows the culture of beers, breadboards and drinking from jam jars to proliferate. But it should proliferate well beyond the city. From Norwood to Newtown, Prospect, Caraga, Seacon to Seacon, the people are calling for small bars, and it's their shout, if you will. One of the great parts of the red tape removal was the reading of the archaic entertainment consent rule, which not only governed where we could listen to music, but what genre of music we could listen to in our licensed premises. Few would believe, if they hadn't seen it themselves, that we used to have liquor licensing rules that dictated that you could play jazz, but not country, that you could play art rock, but not brunch in a venue. These rules were crushing the will of those who would provide both liquor and live music in our vibrant state, and a small venue license was part of the removal of that red tape. Thanks to the new rules, we have dozens of new venues who are hosting live music, and we can enjoy an acoustic set with an aperitif. Now that's a great step forward for the city centre, but there's still a government-sanctioned hipster-proof fence that starts at the parklands. Doesn't have to be this way. We can bring down that hipster-proof wall. Since early 2014, Mr. Rao has had the power to extend these licences beyond those initial CBD limits, but he has failed to do so. That's one small step that we should be taking from this council. As I mentioned, Mr. Rao, in recent weeks, has announced that we're going to move these small venue licences beyond the confines of North Terrace as far as North Adelaide. Well, that's a step that's far too small. That one small step for Chairman Rao is one giant lost opportunity for the rest of the state. And we're waiting for the cultural revolution to reach the rest of the state. Why can't we extend the vibe that has revolutionised those once sleepy CBD laneways to the outer suburban high streets, and indeed to the winding pathways of the hills, and indeed to the Barossa, as the member for Schubert at the time, Ivan Bean, had assumed that piece of legislation would do? Why can't we give our local entrepreneurs a chance to build the hipster bar of their hipster dreams and call it something hipster, like Salami or Epic or Cam Corner? And why can't they do that in Hindmarsh? Why can't we have king-wide cocktails in Colonel Mike Gardens, or freshly foraged, verified vegan artisanal organics in Athelstan? That's why I'm introducing this private members' bill today, because I want to show Chairman Rao, as one wag referred to him, that the hipster-proof fence needs to come down. The cultural revolution of the small bars should be extended to the whole of our state. It may be a vibrant city that this government wants to see, but it should not be at the expense of the rest of the state. The lumber sections of Lowthall, Mighty Joyce and Tavis, and Sangria, closer to home, over in Stirling. Or perhaps we'd like to toast the man